Welcome to Crying Out Cloud, the podcast that will make you laugh, cry, and reconsider all of your cloud security fears. It's Enan and Amitai, yo. And today we have Yuval on to break the news about a super cool vulnerability you found.
Yep, definitely.
Cool. Yuval is a researcher on our vulnerability research team. Previously, he was a principal security researcher at Palo Alto. He is a Microsoft MBR top 10 Azure researcher. And yeah, he's our colleague and he's super cool. So we're super happy to have him on.
Happy to be in.
Okay, you've all discovered a flaw in Amazon's own code build projects. I'm not going to give too much more details. I'm going to let him tell us more himself. But let's start off with, how did you get the idea, the inspiration to work on this research?
So the idea actually came from a threat actor, right as I was joining Wiz. This was a blog about an attacker that managed to take over an AWS GitHub repository. So we saw that and we thought it was really peculiar. I don't know, Amitai, maybe you remember this attack. It was kind of a weird one because the entire motivation of the attacker was to just cause destruction. He apparently didn't like the service or something like that. And he just tried to, you know, cause, he didn't try to like crypto mine or something like that just to cause destruction. And he, although he had a typo in his payload, which caused it to ultimately fail, he was actually able to get his payload to run on like end user computers. So it was a really interesting attack. And that really sparked our interest into AWS CodeBuild, the service, because the entire attack was built by abusing that service.
So how did you find this? Like, what were you looking for?
So when we looked at the original attack, we just tried to understand, how is this even possible? How can you exploit CodeBuild to take over the underlying GitHub repository? And what we found out is that CodeBuild, the way it works, when someone submits a pull request to the GitHub repository, it will trigger a build based on the pull request branch, right? And once that happens, that the code of the build runs in an environment that has credentials to GitHub, like a GitHub token, because CodeBuild needs to do stuff like update the commit status if the build failed or succeeded. And turns out that more often than not, those builds are this token is quite privileged. And we saw that in a lot of cases, it will actually let you take over the entire repository. So we immediately, when we saw this, we went to look for, how does AWS recommend to, you know, not allow this kind of attack, because it's kind of crazy. And we saw that the main mechanism back there was using something that's called an actor ID filter, which basically is just a, you know, a list of user IDs whose pull requests are allowed to trigger builds. So we looked at it, and while it seemed like a valid solution, we thought it was like not the best user experience. Like, for each time someone joins your team, you need to figure out his GitHub user ID and then update this, you know, list on AWS. So we were kind of suspicious and we wanted to check whether, you know, people are actually implementing this correctly, right?
Like as a misconfiguration.
Yep, definitely. If people are actually configuring their code build correctly, so we wrote like a script that looks at GitHub and tries to find something that's called public code build projects. So in code build, you can actually set something that makes your code build settings public just on a web page. So that was extremely helpful for us because we could search for those and actually see their configuration and whether they use an actor ID filter. We found a bunch of AWS repositories that use the actor ID filter. So we were like, okay, good for them. Like, nice. They're actually doing what their documentation says you need to do. And we kind of left it at that and continued to other stuff until like one evening, I don't know why it popped into my head, and something about the syntax of the list seemed a bit off, seemed weird. you would expect it to be like a list of numbers separated by like a comma or something like that, just a list. But it actually was, the separation was a pipe character. Like, I don't know if this is a good indication, but just a pipe character. And then it clicked to us that this is actually a regex. It's not a simple list. And it's well documented. We just didn't saw that. It's actually a regex filter. And the reason is because the actor ID filter is not the only type of filter. You could have like file system path filters and other filters where regex makes sense. And that's why it's the underlying engine. But for a list of IDs, it's not really the best solution. And immediately what we thought about is whether this list was encoded.
What does that mean?
That you put two characters at the end and beginning of a list to ensure that what you are matching is exactly the match. Otherwise, regex would match even if the string contains it. So let's say you're searching for ABC with regex. If you don't put encodes, also 1, 2, 3, ABC, 5, 6, 7 will also match, right? So immediately we thought, wow, if this is possible, we might be able to like bypass this filter.
So what does that look like? I mean, because it sounds like you'd need to have at least a partial match, right? In order to make this work.
Yeah.
So how do you exploit that?
I would say that Nir didn't thought it was exploitable. Nir is our head of research. He didn't think it would work. I immediately called him and I was like, wow, we might be able to bypass it. He was like, no way this is going to work.
I was like, we're putting this on the record that Nir did not believe this could work.
I'm putting this on the record. But after he saw that, he was supportive at the end. Anyway, so like you say, we wanted to be able to understand if we could even get like a GitHub user whose ID is a super string of like an approved maintainer ID, right? So that got us to look into, you know, how even GitHub IDs are distributed. And it turns out that they are just a sequential like list. So the first GitHub user has ID 1. Then like in 2015, IDs have like 4 digits. Then in 2020, they ballooned to like 7 digits. And today they are already at 9 digits.
What did you do next? You figured this out and then?
And then we had a lot of luck because AWS actually employs really, I would say, early GitHub users. So their ideas were kind of relatively short. They had like 6 or 7 7-digit ideas. So that meant that right now, because there are already 9-digit IDs, we could actually find an ID that is like a super string, like contains the ID of an approved maintainer.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
So how did you action this? What did you do?
So we needed to claim an ID that actually contains the smaller ID, like the approved ID. We know that those IDs are out there. The thing is that GitHub creates like 200,000 users every day. Right? So it's kind of hard to get a specific ID because a lot of users are being created all the time, right? So we needed a way to like automatically create a lot of users in a second so we can catch the ID that we want, right? We had a target ID that we want to catch and we wanted to, when we see that this ID is about to come up, it's about to be created, we wanted to just create a flood of new users. And we found a way to do that using GitHub apps. It turns out that when you register an app, it also creates like a bot user. So when we did that, we were actually able to create a lot of GitHub apps very quickly. And that allowed us to create a flood of new users and actually claim an ID that was a super string of an approved maintainer ID.
Could you use this to like for other reasons? Like, let's say you really want a specific ID number, like a vanity license plate. Like, could the same technique be applicable?
I love Eden.
you could definitely do something like that. I don't know if GitHub will patch it soon, but as of right now, you can do that, yeah.
You should buy them while they're hot, while they're still while it's still possible.
Yeah.
Okay, so tell us about, let's call it D-Day, the day that you ran the script to actually to do this in the flesh. What happened? What did you have for breakfast? How'd you run the script? How long did it take?
Yeah, so we actually, there were 2 days. We were like preparing everything, and then it was already like 8 p.m. and me and Nir looked each other in the eyes and we're like, okay, let's not do an all-nighter, let's just go to sleep and do it fresh in the morning. So we came fresh in the morning and we chose a target. The target was the AWS SDK for JavaScript. It was one of the, you know, affected the repositories that had this vulnerable actor ID filter. So we created a demo environment first, but when we actually did it, it was definitely nerve-wracking, and it actually took much more time than we expected because they use like a huge machine for their build with like, I don't know, 70 CPUs and huge memory. So everything was so slow, which really added to the pressure, I would say. But after we submitted the PR from the user that we created that had the correct ID that could bypass the filter, it worked. We got the GitHub token from the build environment. We checked its permission. It was quite a powerful user. It was basically an admin of the repository. And that was, you know, we expected it to happen, but it was still definitely quite shocking.
So what could an attacker have done with this? Like if the evil Yuval somewhere in Russia, let's say, would have brought this to his boss, the evil Nir, and they decided to pursue this, what could they have done with this?
A lot, actually, because this repository, we chose it because we thought it really demonstrated the impact, because it is present based on our analysis in like 2/3 of cloud environments. It is heavily used, this SDK. And one of its users is actually the AWS console. So this code in this repository runs inside the AWS console, which is basically the brain of like the entire AWS cloud. Every user uses it. So if you manage to use these admin privileges of the repository to push, you know, malicious code, that could potentially end up in like millions of AWS consoles, which is quite scary. And it's not, you know, we obviously decided not to do that, not to do like a POC of that, because we were like, we didn't want to touch something that...
Because you're the good Yuval, you're not the evil Yuval.
Yeah, definitely. But it's not like only a theoretical attack, because just a month before we saw like the attack that we discussed at the beginning, that someone actually did that and managed to get his payload to end users. So we know this is actually something that, you know, it could work. So we are really happy that we found it in time and we were able to get it disclosed to AWS.
But let's say right now, first of all, it's super cool, but let's say right now you're an AWS customer, which likely you are. Do you need to be concerned about this? Like AWS is using their SDK also internally. So what's the impact on any given AWS user?
It could have been massive, but thankfully AWS patched it. It's no longer an issue. So right now you shouldn't be concerned. I'd say you could, like if you are using AWS code build, there are definitely lessons here for you as well, because AWS here is basically a user of AWS code build with a, you know, a big misconfiguration or flaw.
So the misconfiguration is still possible. Like someone else could make the same mistake again tomorrow.
Yep, definitely. But it's AWS released actually some features now that make it easier to like make sure only approved maintainers are able to create builds. So there are actually new improvements that AWS introduced as a response to that original attack that allow you to not be able, you don't need to maintain a list anymore, right? You just need to enable it, and AWS behind the scenes checks the permission of the user that created the PR. And if he has an appropriate permission, like you can see that he's the owner of the repository, only then a build will be triggered. But the thing is that this is only for new code build projects. This is only enabled by default for new code build projects. And so if you have an existing one, you should really, like, it's also the biggest recommendation in the blog post. You should definitely enable this feature. It's super important.
What would be the equivalent here in other platforms similar to code build? Like, is it likely that the customers of other competing platforms might need to be worried about this sort of thing as well?
I think it's relevant anywhere that you have like an external CI system to where your source code is. So because a lot of time that CI system needs to be able to interact back to the source repository. So normally GitHub, but it could be GitLab or Bitbucket or any of those platforms. And it needs to like report, it needs a token to report back what happens in the build. And it's the job of the underlying CI system to make sure that that token, if possible, isn't exposed to build and that by default, it doesn't have a lot of permission. A few months ago, there was another issue in a CodeRabbit, I think, that was pretty severe, that had something to do similar to that, where credentials were in the build. So it's definitely important to make sure the token, the privileges that you give your CI system over the source code are limited. Yeah.
You worked closely with Amazon around the disclosure. Obviously, what was that like?
Oh, they were great. They actually fixed it, I think, in less than, I don't know if it was 24 or 48 hours, but they immediately disabled the projects and then introduced the fixes. And also they made this, you know, amazing feature, which is a much, much easier to use. So everyone can actually benefit from a better, you know, better configuration for CodeBuild.
Okay. Anything else you want to impart to people about this vulnerability? Anything else they should know?
I think the lesson is that you should never have builds with privileged permissions that can be triggered from external pull requests. This is like the first, there are a lot of improvements that you can make to your CI/CD system defenses, but this is like number one. You shouldn't allow external users to be able to trigger builds in your environment. That's like the most important thing and the most important lesson.
We should print that as our title. Yuval, congrats. This is super cool. And thank you for explaining it to people. Even I understood it, which means I think everyone can understand it. Yeah, have a good one. If you enjoyed the show, be sure to subscribe and share a link to the podcast, but not your cloud keys. And as always, if your cloud security strategy is making you cry, don't worry. Just cry out loud.